Hi, I'm Bill Kristol. Welcome back to Conversations. I'm very pleased to have with me today Jonah Goldberg, senior editor at National Review, author of two best-selling books, at least two, very much worth reading, Liberal Fascism and the Tyranny of Clichés, which I recommend to everyone. And I want to say that I recommend particularly, all your stuff is excellent, of course, but your newsletter, which since I've had to write it, or had to, but I've written a newsletter on my own the last year or two, yours is so superior and really the best of the genre. I think you're the newsletterist of our time, and people can, I guess, subscribe to it, but they can also read it on National Review's website.
Yeah, so it's
website.
Called The Goldberg File, and I was actually arguably one of the very first political bloggers.
Yes.
Mickey Kouse got his idea for Kouse Files from The Goldberg File, and then Andrew Sullivan got his idea for his blog from Mickey Kouse. And
so when did you begin that?
98?
Yeah, you were really early.
And internet years, I'm Methuselah, right?
Yeah, right.
and so it originally started out as an blog before the word blog actually came up. And then, I want to warn viewers, because you have a very high-minded, serious viewership
that's
on the show.
That's us.
You know. And they'll think, after, watching you talk to Harvey Mansfield and all these, eminent greases, and then you recommend my newsletter, and they find that I'm writing a lot about my dog and about women's prison movies, and they might be get a little whiplash. So it's an irreverent newsletter at times.
Right. It's a mix of the high and the low. But no, but you're excellent at pulling that off and teaching people something with a very light touch. Well, I don't know if a light touch is what we need now for the so it's July 12th. It's the Tuesday before the Republican convention. You and I have been, I think, reasonably prominent critics of Donald Trump, but also I think we've tried to analyze what's happened. And so let's begin with that. Then we'll go back and discuss liberalism, conservatism, but what happened? Why?
Clearly, ours is the God of the Old Testament. He's a vengeful God. it's funny. It really depends on where you. It's one of these things where first there was the flood, right?
It's one
of the things you can go way back on. I think that it's a little pat to say it now because a lot of people have said this, but I think on the political side, one of the things that's been going on for a long time is that elites, and by elites, I mean pro-Trump elites and anti-Trump elites, I mean people at Fox News, I mean Ted Cruz, I mean Rush Limbaugh, but I also mean Paul Ryan and Erica, everybody has overpromised and underdelivered, at least on the conservative side, but also on the liberal side. If you look at Barack Obama, who came riding in on his Pegasus and the Greek columns, and he was going to heal all our wounds and all that. And so Washington and politics in general has been overpromising what it can do. And the disconnect between the progressive, pragmatic cult of expertise, we know how to manage everything, or the Republican disconnect between being able to kill Obamacare and all that, massive disillusionment, particularly in the wake of a financial crisis. There's actually an interesting article in the I think it's called the European Review of Political Science, that goes back and has a data set going back to the early 1800s of what happens to politics after financial crises.
Yeah.
And it is a pretty strong, robust showing. I never trust when, particularly European ones, but when academics say they have a definition of right wing, because when you start peeling it back, going back to Theodore Adorno, you find out it's not right. But they say politics gets more right-wing, it certainly gets more populist, and so you had this financial crisis that that really wiped out the net worth of people at the bottom half of this country. And then you had a guy come in promising to do all these things and couldn't deliver. And the Republican Party, I think somewhat cynically, because a lot of conservative people in the media said that Obama can be stopped in every way, shape, and form. And so there's a massive sense of disillusionment, and we need some outsider. So that's the political part of it. But I also think if you just go back.
I do think Republican elites and candidates, I guess Romney in 2012 particularly, as the one Republican presidential candidate between the financial crisis now, just didn't show that they had come to grips with it. I've always thought
right.
this. I mean, George Bush, we might have fancy arguments why it was caused by liberal policies and Barney Frank and all the, the Fed.
Right.
But the Americans looked up, and there was George W. Bush, President of the United States, his Secretary of the Treasury, appointed by him, seeming to be a Republican, seeming Republican at least. Republicans had held Congress for 12 years, basically, until November of 06. And then the whole world financial system is falling apart, and they need, if you're the party that has presided over that, you need to have an explanation of what happened.
That's right.
And I think there wasn't one.
And I've grown to my esteem for Mitt Romney in the Trump moment,
right,
and for Stu Stevens, his campaign manager or senior advisor, whatever his title was, has grown dramatically.
Right.
But at the same time, I think Stu Stevens and Mitt Romney subscribe to a theory that it was simply a referendum on Obama, that they were going to be vanilla. You know, vanilla is the most popular ice cream in America, even though it's nobody's favorite flavor, but it's everybody's second favorite flavor.
Right, right.
And that's the kind of campaign they ran. They didn't, I mean, you were writing about this, Steve Hayes was writing about this. They didn't put forward big, serious ideas. They didn't make a serious argument. And I think that was part of the problem, is that he seemed milquetoasty against Obama. The Republican rhetoric for 4 years is how we're losing our country. And then Mitt Romney kind of runs this Hallmark ad of a campaign. And there was a lot of bitterness. And I think Ted Cruz comes out of that, and a lot of things come out of that. But I also think it's worth getting outside of the Beltway analysis of this. And, you know, probably the most important book in the last 10 years is Charles Murray's Coming Apart, at least in terms of the issues that it addresses. And the unraveling of the social structure for people in what he calls Fishtown, the sort of lower end, non-college educated. He only concentrates on whites, which is the sort of base of the Trump support. They aren't church going anymore. Their family breakdown is as bad as it was for blacks when Moynihan did the Moynihan Report. And if you look at the Pew surveys and the Gallup surveys going back 30 years, we have never had such lack of faith and confidence in major institutions in American life. The last time I looked at it, virtually every institution in America except for two, small business and the army, were underwater. Cops were right on the bubble. But obviously the media, no
Terrible.
Faith, right?
Right?
Congress, no faith. But also doctors, lawyers, educators, primary schools,
religious institutions,
every institution you can think of, people have lost faith in. And that is, I think, the feedstock for populism, both on the left and on the right. And, you know, that's what we had in the 1930s. That's what you get when people feel deracinated and alienated. And we can talk more about that in a bit. But I think that was going on right in front of everybody's eyes, and we were talking about it in a very AI analytical way, and Charles gave wonderful speeches on it. And I think if Charles had been more of a political analyst rather than a social scientist type, he might have just added a last chapter on there saying, and something terrible was coming.
Right.
And we kind of missed it.
It is amazing. I mean, 45% of the voters in this primary season in 2016 voted for Sanders or Trump. A socialist who hasn't changed his mind about anything in 50 years.
Right. And who, since his honeymoon in the Soviet Union.
Exactly. And whose economic views, which were already somewhat discredited, you might have thought when he adopted them, now seem ridiculous, honestly.
Right. Right.
And then Trump, who's a kind of authoritarian populist with also a smorgasbord of views, many of which are not credible, really, views. But it does say something about a degree of alienation, I suppose, from, you know, the establishment and the mainstream. It's a little worrisome, though, 45% of the electorate. And what's weirder for me, though, is it's not the 30s. It's one thing if you're having a Great Depression and unemployment lines and the Dust Bowl and all that. But for all the troubles of 08, you know, things have recovered, unemployment.
Yeah.
I know there's
underemployment. Totally fair point.
And so why is that, though, do you think? That is really, I'm very struck by that. And one can take the attitude of people are just spoiled and expect too much and should toughen up. And, you know, your colleague Kevin Williamson has written in that vein, I think, quite powerfully, or one can say, no, you've got to be more sympathetic, and somehow there is suffering sort of out there.
I'm sort of with you. I am not an economic determinist on these sorts of things, but I'm also not someone who just discounts the economics either, right? Economic, you know, if you saw your entire net worth, which is basically invested in your house, disappear in 2008, that is going to have a lasting impact on the way you see things.
Especially after the experts told you it couldn't happen anymore, or we've got everything under control.
That's right. You know, right? I think the Brexit stuff is illuminating on all of this as well. There is, and I've been writing about this for a long time, and probably not stridently enough, but there is a real sense in which, and Ross Douthat had a good column about this, in which the sort of the Davos attending, New York, London, top call it 2%, right, or 5%, that they just simply look down their nose at the idea of national culture, nationhood. You know, this "Make America Great Again" is clearly an appeal to a white lower middle class, white middle class memory of nostalgic, bogus memory, but a memory of what they think the 1950s and early 1960s was like, and the sort of contempt for notions of sovereignty, both legally and sort of culturally. You know, Supreme Court justices saying they consult laws and polls in foreign countries, and you can go down the list. And, you know, I remember saying about Barack Obama's speech in Berlin that it was better than the original Esperanto. You know? And I think that if you're struggling to make ends meet and you get this real sense that the elites, cultural elites, people hold commanding heights, see themselves as better than you and better than America, you know, that whether it was a fair, out-of-context thing for everyone to beat up on, that Obama saying, "I believe in American exceptionalism the way that British do," it reinforces something that people suspect, that there was just a lot of people who don't like America. When Obama first came in, we were writing about this a lot, in part because it tied into my book, but, you know, there's a history of progressivism in the United States that has always thought there's nothing wrong with America that being more like Europe wouldn't fix. And I think we've seen that time and again, and it comes in waves, and when you have the sort of juice box mafia, wonky Washington expert types really looking with disdain down on people who say, "No, you know, I don't want to be America. I don't want to be Europe. I want to be America. I like America. And I like the way America used to be more than the way it is now." There's a cultural ferment that comes from all of that, and it strips people away from an ideological attachment into a more nativist, nationalistic attachment.
And the normal conservative candidates somehow didn't speak to that enough.
I think that's right.
Maybe because they were the accident that Bush and Rubio especially were liberal on immigration, or maybe because, I mean, Trump benefited a lot, don't you think, from having Jeb Bush as his kind of alter ego, or whatever way to say that is.
I think that's right.
Third Bush, the establishment personified.
And also the prospect of watching a Bush-Clinton race was so disgusting, particularly to conservatives. It was like, no, we don't do that here. I do think that Mike Huckabee has figured this out a long time ago. He just has too much baggage, and he's too many other problems with him as a candidate. And I think Ted Cruz figured out the problem for Ted Cruz, and I've become much more of a fan of Ted Cruz.
And Rick Santorum in between.
And Rick Santorum
semi figured it out. I mean,
but they couldn't. First of all, there was a problem of breaking out of the. First of all, this idiotic thing that one of the reasons why I think the primaries went so badly is everyone bought into this theory about lanes.
Yeah. Right.
Right. And Trump at least had one message for everybody, and I think that a lot of these guys, you know, Ted Cruz is kind of a global elite kind of guy, but he's figured out this formula about cultural Texan stuff, and it just doesn't translate well. The media wouldn't give him the kind of play he needed to do it. And meanwhile, Trump could, because he had this celebrity status. I mean, it is a bizarre thing. You said before about Sanders and Trump getting 45% of the electorate. You know, I've read a lot about populism over the last 100 years, and the notion that the two populist firebrand candidates, one would be a Jewish socialist from Brooklyn, and sounds like a Jewish socialist from Brooklyn. I mean, he sounds like he wants to send back soup at a deli. And then Donald Trump, a billionaire from Fifth Avenue. I mean, these are the guys that people normally are pointing the pitchforks at, not, you know, having them on their own side. And I think that speaks to something that's changed in the media landscape as well.
But also, but populist rebellions are sometimes led by these billionaire, you know, wealthy people who were sort of semi-faux populists, right?
Sure.
I mean, there's sometimes it really is the person, you know, with a pitchfork from modest origins, but often it's a kind of someone who exploits, you might say, these...
I think that's right. There is a certain, you know, there's a French intellectual, I can't remember who he is, who says, "The people have decided, and I must go with them, for I am their leader."
Yeah, right?
But I always liken it to Ferris Bueller, where he sees a parade going down the avenue in Chicago, and he runs out in front and pretends he's leading it.
Right.
Trump saw this thing and got in front of it.
And that's what he's good at. He's a marketer. He sees trends, right?
And
the reality TV thing helped him.
And he's also always been a New York City populist. He's a New York Post populist. He cares more about sort of New York Post and what the cops and construction workers and Dorman and Howard Stern and what those guys care about, and never liked the sort of Park Avenue real estate elite. And because he's got a huge Queens chip on his shoulder.
Yeah.
And as two guys from Manhattan, I think we can recognize it a little bit better than some people can.
Yes, and even sympathize with it in certain ways.
Yeah, no, sure.
The other thing I think is that, I mean, Huckabee, I do agree, really saw this with the economic populism. I remember in 07, 08. And I was my first column for my somewhat ill-fated year-long weekly column stint with the New York Times was a semi-defense of Huckabee and taking him seriously as a candidate. And I think correctly predicting he'd do better than people thought, because of the economic populist message. One forgets how much disdain that was met with from conservative elites.
Yeah.
I mean, they were right perhaps to be disdainful on the merits, but also even politically, just a total lack of understanding that he was hitting something there. And then Santorum the same.
Yeah.
People thought their appeal was social conservative, which it was to some degree. But the big development this year strikes me from a kind of conservative, intra-conservative movement dynamics point of view. Trump, weirdly or brilliantly or something, figured out that the populist conservatism would work better when it was detached from religious conservatism.
That's
or
right,
social conservatism, and before they had kind of gone together.
Yeah.
That I don't know. I don't know. Did anyone predict that?
That's I didn't see it coming. And but it's also, you know, it's important to remember that there is an aspect of cult of personality here, right? And so, you know, we like ideas. We tend to be like the guy who looks for his car keys where the light is good, right? We want to see these things as even his separation from ideas, we think, is an interesting idea, right? And it's important to remember that, I mean, that a lot of people, you know, one of my favorite lines is from William Jennings Bryan, where he says, "The people of Nebraska are for free silver, therefore I am for free silver." And there is one of my first big Goldberg file newsletter things attacking Trump, I was pointing out that Trump is corrupting conservatism to a large extent. They did a poll last summer where they asked Republicans whether or not they're in favor of single payer healthcare. Now, you and I can probably recall that conservatives and Republicans spent a good deal of time talking about this, right?
Forget
Reagan's Medicare speech and all that kind of stuff. Just the fight over Obamacare divided American politics for a long time. And you would think, even though we didn't persuade enough Americans, even though a majority still don't like Obamacare, that we'd pretty much persuaded our own side about this. And so 14% said they were in favor of single payer. That's too high, but that's manageable. They were then told that Donald Trump was in favor of it, and the number went up to 44%.
Yeah.
And so I think that what Trump is doing is in the classic sort of populist tradition of just simply being a vehicle for resentment and rage, and if he changes his mind, who cares, right? If he becomes pro-life, if he says he's pro-life, if he says he's pro-choice, you know, we spent 10 years talking about how terrible eminent domain abuse was. All Trump had to do was say, "Oh, I think it's wonderful," and all of a sudden my Twitter feed is lighting up with people saying, "You're an idiot, you don't get how great eminent domain is," you know?
Yeah.
And what's dismaying for people like us, I think, and for a lot of people, is that we actually are principled conservatives, and we actually do wear this stuff fairly close to our hearts, and to discover that a lot of our comrades in arms don't, or at least they're willing to jettison it when you get this, you know, reality show celebrity to come along, it's a very depressing thing, you know.
Yeah.
And it tells you how quickly countries can go in a bad direction given the right set of circumstances.
Well, let's talk about that, because you've written very eloquently, I think powerfully, on that. It's just, I think intelligent conservatives, I've put us in that, maybe in that category, but well, let's say perceptive conservatives. I've always understood there's populism and there's conservatism,
right.
And obviously one of the tasks of politics, if you're a conservative leader, this would be true on the left too, of course, is to harness, educate, refine, you might say, the populism, but also respect it in a way and make it part of a broader movement. And obviously Reagan did that, and Gingrich in the 90s and others. So I don't really, sort of silly to blame the populace. I mean, what are they, you know, Trump is a celebrity, people are interested in celebrities. There's that the intermediate layer, which I would say is the elected officials, prominent conservative leaders, are supposed to both educate the populist sentiment and also check it at times, and also at times just say, "No, I'm sorry, that's unacceptable." And I think you and I have both been struck, I mean, how few people have done that.
Yeah.
And that is a little depressing, don't you think, or worrying?
Oh, it's terrifying. And what I find particularly amazing is the number of people who, you know, because my position has always been, look, I don't like either of them. I'm just going to tell the truth, let the chips fall where they may. I don't think that, you know, my only job is to tell the truth as I see it, right? Doesn't mean I have to say everything I believe, and it doesn't mean I can't change my mind, but, you know, just my only real definition of journalistic ethics is don't write or say things you don't believe to be true. And it is amazing how many people are, longtime fans, are disappointed in me because I won't live down to their expectations, right?
Right, right?
They just sort of assumed, implicitly or explicitly, that I was, in fact, a Republican hack. And that if ultimately it was in the interest of the Republican Party for something to go one way, that I would, of course, rejoin the fold and start writing things that I don't believe to be true. And what has been, and we don't need to name names here, but it has been dismaying and shocking and revealing how many people are perfectly prepared to do exactly that. And I mean, Bill Rusher used to be the publisher of National Review. He'd always tell the young staffers, he would give them the same piece of advice. He would say, look, politicians will always disappoint you. And it wasn't to say that politicians were bad people. It was just simply that their incentive structure versus, like, say, you or my incentive structure is different. And they're going to go, their first priority is to win elections. And that requires compromising on principles in a way that, you know, huddled away writers don't have to do. And I respect that and I understand that. But there's a difference between bending your principles and defenestrating your principles. And that's sort of what we've been seeing.
Now, that's what strikes me. I mean, Reagan wasn't a pure free trader.
Right.
And everyone, you know, Bush had bigger government programs than he probably would have liked and certainly the conservatives liked. But that's all a matter of accommodating to political reality.
Right.
While staying basically on a path that is reasonable and defensible from our point of view. I think for us, I guess, Trump just seems utterly unacceptable. Almost more, I'd say, almost because of his personal character and judgment.
I think that's right.
I mean, also because he's not a conservative in 18 different ways. But that's actually less important for me and I think for you than just the basic unfitness for office and the willingness of people who have in the past written eloquently about fitness for office and disdain for Clinton and disdain...
Or the need for conservative purity. You know, I mean, all of these supposedly high priests of conservatism who've been yelling at reform conservatives like Yuval Levin and Ramesh Panuru and, you know, saying, oh, you're just a Me Too Republican. And
suddenly,
And suddenly, all of a sudden, they just completely change course is shocking to me. And it's funny, though. It's like, because I know you've always had a sympathy for a sort of populism and shaking things up and not being, you know, constrained by a silly Overton window on this issue or that issue. And I call it the Trump non sequitur, right? I am really sympathetic to most of the arguments for Trump until you get to the and therefore Trump part, right? So if it's, oh, we need to shake up the Beltway elite, they failed. Yes, absolutely. We need to talk more about national sovereignty. Sure, absolutely. We need to do this, we need to do that. We need to break out of this nostalgic window of 1981 Reaganite tax reform and apply Reaganite principles to new problems. Absolutely. And then they say, and therefore we have to vote for Donald Trump. And I'm like, are you high? And what are you talking about?
Right.
And I think that it's been a kind of an amazing thing to see the extent to which the power of Donald Trump, you know, this is something I write about a lot in Tearing Cliches. We all talk about that phrase, power corrupts and absolute power corrupts, absolutely, right? That's not what Lord Acton meant when he actually coined the phrase. He was writing to a friend of his who was writing a biography of the popes and or a history of the popes, and Acton was cautioning him to say, you can't forgive really powerful people sins that you wouldn't forgive in other people. And what he's talking about is not that the power corrupts the powerful, it's that it corrupts the people chronicling and around him, right? Because you start to bend your principles to power. And you can see that all over the place these days where because he got the nomination or because he gets good ratings on TV, all sorts of people are willing to sort of throw aside things that they believed in for a long time. And the way I always try to describe it, at least to sympathetic audiences, because it's harder and harder to find them, is that all of my life, you know, I was a huge disciple of your dad's, and, you know, my first job in Washington was at AEI. All of my life, conservatism has, you strip away the context and the day-to-day arguments or the yearly arguments, conservatism only stood for two things. The idea that ideas matter, right? That through a contest of rational debate and the application of evidence applied to theory that you can come to optimal solutions and problems. And the idea that character matters. And you can define character as sexual mores, or you can define character as business practices, or you can define character as public integrity or private integrity or honesty. I've yet to come up. It's sort of a challenge. I keep asking people, and with the exception of his allegedly wonderful children, who may in fact be wonderful, no one has come up with anything close to a definition of character that Donald Trump doesn't fall far short from. And I plan on being in this business for a while longer. I think you plan on being in this business for a while longer. I would like to be able to say that character matters and that ideas matter 5 years from now, when Trump has faded away, you know? And if you don't want to say that those things matter and it's just a hammer and tongs battle for power, make that argument. But don't pretend that Trump is this vessel of great ideas or of great character, or that with him in power, the wheat harvests will be wonderful and all this kind of stuff, you know? Right.
So how much of a crisis is this for concern? Well, what do you think is going to happen? I guess we could stipulate that we don't know and we've been wrong, but I mean, what's the safest bet, I suppose, is Trump loses in November.
Yeah.
So what happens? I mean, it happened, it was weird, it was a very unusual election, 17 candidates, et cetera, Republican elites out of touch, we're back to where we were. Or how much of a moment of a crisis, of an inflection point is this?
Well, I think there is a significant silver lining to Trump in the sense that there is going to be, you know, it's sort of like sometimes you have to burn the village to save it kind of thing, right? If Trump is the nominee and he loses, the idea that, first of all, some of our friends on talk radio or some of my colleagues at Fox News can go back to arguing for a doctrinaire definition of conservatism, I find unpersuasive, right? And as a friend of mine, a colleague of mine at AEI likes to say, what we're seeing is a bubble. And when you have a bubble in the private sector, the smart money goes to quality, right? It doesn't try to chase the bubble. It says, we're going to double down on the sort of Warren Buffett school of fundamentals, right? And so if and when the bubble bursts, I think people are going to be looking around to the people who, first of all, didn't lose their heads, and second of all, have serious public policy proposals that they can bring to bear. And I think there's a robust debate about what those proposals are. I'm very sympathetic to the reform conservative guys and the guys who write for, like, National Affairs.
Yeah.
And there are too many magazines with the first name National out there.
Correct, yeah.
and I think that, you know, one of the things that has been crippling for conservatives is that we keep trying to replay this 1981 tax reform model as a solution to all of our problems. And, you know, I will name two names. You know, they're friends of mine, but at least I hope they're still friends of mine. But Steve Moore and Larry Kudlow, who I do not think have colored themselves with honor in all of this, they've been at the forefront of arguing pure Reaganite cut card marginal income tax rates and all that kind of stuff. And they've thrown in pretty emotionally for Donald Trump. It would be very difficult when even Donald Trump hasn't really come out for that. I mean, or at least not plausibly come out for that, to say that that argument, we have to revert back to that sort of argument. And the Wall Street Journal, which I have immense respect for, has also sort of been hard to peg on a lot of this. And I think that's good. I think that it may just be rubble, but at least when everything's reduced to rubble, you have a clear lines to fight from. And I think the people who stuck to principles and stuck to the importance of arguments and character will be better equipped. Because it's just a hunch, but I don't think Donald Trump will comport himself well in defeat. If he wins, well, then I think it's time to restart the Liberty League and go back to the notion of being in exile. I've been rereading Mencken and Albert J. Nock.
Is that right?
Uh-huh. And, you know, and what they both, more Nock, I mean, I've always loved Nock. I wrote a long piece about him in National Review years ago. But they were simply outside the political consensus of both parties. It was statism was running amok everywhere. And they just simply said, we're not going to be part of that. And so it could be that sort of traditional fusionist conservatives, become a lot like the Libertarian Party has been for the last 40 years, where they're involved in the argument, but they're more at the periphery than certainly we're used to. And that's okay. I mean, I could live with that in terms of my career or, you know, I'll enjoy the arguments. But I do worry what it means for the country to have two competing brands of statism between the two parties. I think that's a really bad prospect for the country.
Yeah, for me, what's so shocking is if the Tea Party was about anything, it was about constitutionalism, maybe sometimes maybe a little simple-minded, but an attempt to rediscover the Constitution and right. limited government. If you think about the conservative intellectual movement for 20, 30, 40 years, different aspects of it in different ways were about this, though.
Sure.
Certainly on the legal side with Scalia and Bork and all, you know, the originalism, the Constitution, limited government. There's a libertarian side of that, a traditional side of that, you might say.
Right.
The Hayekian side of you know, the limits of central planning. I would have said, if someone asked me, what is modern American conservatism about? I don't know, there would have been some other things as well, the
sure.
anti-communism and hawkishness and... But that would have been a big part of it, you know.
No, I
and
not.
Trump has no interest in any of that.
Yeah, no,
it's a little shocking that he can, and that no one seems to care. I guess not no one, but so
yeah,
many people don't care.
I sometimes wonder if and I was very pro Tea Party. It was the first populist movement in American history that I was in favor of because I thought they were going to fulfill the ancient libertarian prophecy of the libertarians taking over the government and then leaving everybody alone.
Yeah,
you know?
Right.
Because normally populism is about imposing will, using the state as a mechanism of power or a lever of power for one specific constituency that defines itself as the people. And, you know, historically, all populism means is peopleism. And Hitler was a populist and a nationalist. Hitler liked to say he was a nationalist but not a patriot. I think John Lukacs has written a lot of wonderful things about populism, and so I had high hopes for the Tea Parties as well, and I wonder if the sense that they failed to get Mitt Romney elected, the sense that they were betrayed by the Republican establishment, caused a lot of them to say, well, hey, you guys told us that if we doubled down on our principles,
right,
we would solve everything. Well, we delivered. And then you guys failed us. And so they're like, screw it. Now I just want to win.
Yeah.
And that's what Trump's, you know,
message. And I want a tougher guy who,
strength, will. I mean, where have we heard those themes in politics before?
Yeah.
And winning, you know, he says winning solves everything. And I think that that's really dismaying. I've been planning on writing this piece for National Review for a while on sort of revisiting liberal fascism almost 10 years later and what I've learned, because the book was largely written to hold off Hillary Clinton. I'd never heard of Barack Obama when I started writing that book. And here comes Donald Trump, and he's proved me wrong about some things. And it's dismaying, but I should be honest about it.
Well, I want to hear about that in just a second. That sounds, but the only other, I guess, my footnote to what you were saying, which I very much agree with, is, and I do think religious conservatives, so the Tea Party conservatives, in a way, got frustrated, and some of them, not all of them, because some of the leaders of Never Trump are Tea Party types.
Sure.
Very much to their credit, I think.
Yes, yes.
This is not why they got involved as grassroots citizens fighting against Obamacare.
That's a very important point. There are many rooms in the mansion of Tea Partiness.
But some did, of course, go in a Trumpian direction. I always used to say, and I think you and I were very similar on this in 2009, 2010, when the left was just deriding the Tea Party as some incipient fascism. So, to the contrary, I mean, this is a healthy populism. What does it believe in? It believes in dealing with the national debt and restoring the Constitution.
Right.
You should be happy we have this kind of populism, not European populism.
Right.
Now, it turned out, unfortunately, 5 years later, we have a European style of...
Because the Tea Party failed, right? I mean,
or
didn't succeed.
Yeah, I agree. I mean, right.
Whether it was their fault or somebody else's fault.
Or they thought they failed, or they were frustrated, let's say,
But historically, populist movements do not want to be constrained by the constitutional bulwarks of democratic liberalism.
The old order, right.
And this was one of the first movements that said, no, constrain us, and that was why I thought it was healthy.
And then the religious conservatives, which is a cousin, you might say, of the Tea Party, but goes back much further as part of the Republican and conservative base. I mean, there, for all the complaints, and I was occasionally sympathetic to some of them, though I was mostly a defender of the religious right and social conservatism, and part of it, really, with the complaints about the dogmatism, the moralism, the religious focus, imposing religion on the society. it turns out the only thing worse than religious, you know, than religious conservatism is non-religious,
yeah.
or religious populism is non-religious populism,
no, that,
right?
That
and my friend Gary Bauer has an interesting perspective on this, and he's much more sympathetic to Trump than I am, but when explaining why so many of his supporters,
yeah.
the people who subscribe, take his news, to get his end of the day facts and email, I guess now, originally it was a fax. why are they for Trump? I said he's not socially conservative, he's not
yeah.
religious, his personal behavior is the opposite of what people uphold. And Gary's line was, look, they told us, vote Republican, at least we'll be able to, we'll be an alliance, we'll save traditional marriage, we'll
yeah.
begin to roll back Roe v. Wade, and so forth. And it turned out that none of that worked. And so religious conservatives have decided, apparently, they'll try to take care of their communities as best they can, protect
yeah.
them from the forces on the outside. But meanwhile, they're just going to vote their economic interests
right.
or grievances. And so liberated from the constraints of a kind of
yeah.
religious view
yeah.
in politics, they become just populist conservatives.
Right. Which is sort of gets back to my point earlier about how everyone overpromised and underdelivered. Everyone says we're going to get rid of Roe v. Wade. Everyone
right.
says we're going to save marriage. And then you don't do it.
Republican chief justices,
right? You get Republican
Obamacare
chief,
or Republican
right.
Reagan appointee and Anthony Kennedy and so forth. Yeah.
And so I don't. That's one of the things I think. There are a lot of people who think, and I'm sure you get this too, that think we're snobs because we don't like Trump or that we hate the Trump supporters. I am, for the most part. I mean, yeah, there's some jackasses in the mix, as there are in every movement, but the typical, person sympathetic to Trump or frustrated with the GOP, I think some of their arguments are wrong, but I have nothing but sympathy for them and their frustrations. I think they're coming from the right place. Again, I just think it's the Trump non sequitur. It's like, if the argument didn't end with, and therefore this corrupt flimflam man who takes advantage of ignorant or desperate people as his business model, and who has more ex-wives than the previous 43 presidents combined, and makes things up and lies. If it had been somebody of serious character, but of real populist sentiment, or someone of serious ideas, but of populist sentiment, I wouldn't be making these arguments, or I wouldn't be standing athwart the GOP right now. But sometimes you just have to.
And the person matters. I mean, the truth
yeah.
is, you can go too far in the kind of, well, I like Trump, I like their sentiments, but not Trump. But if the sentiments become allied to and embodied in someone who now is likely to be the nominee of one of the two major parties for president of the United States, you don't get to separate. I mean,
that's right.
Ultimately, you could separate them next year or something
sure.
like that, but 4 months, they don't get separated.
That's right.
And I think that's a real problem, don't you think? I mean, I think people are underestimating the negative effect, actually, on conservatism and on the Republican Party. I'm curious what you think of this, of Trump as the nominee. I mean, it's one thing for him to be the presumptive nominee,
yeah.
win some primaries, speech at a convention, assuming he beats back the delegate revolt, which I hope he doesn't, but let's just say he does. Speech at a convention watched by 15 million people, debates watched by God knows how many people,
right.
Clinton-Trump debates will get a big audience.
Yeah, yeah.
I don't know, how do you tell a 25-year-old, well, that's not, he happens to be the nominee of the Republican Party,
right.
and every Republican you've ever heard of, with a very few exceptions, is supporting him,
right.
but he's not really what the Republican Party's about. Well, what does that mean at some point? I mean,
he's the chief spokesman of the party, right? And everyone is swearing fealty and loyalty to their standard bearer, and I think that's exactly right. I mean, again, one of the sort of silver linings to all of this is we may go back to the days of reinforcing this important distinction that I think got way too lost in the Bush years, is that there's a difference between being a Republican and being a conservative. And again, if it weren't Donald Trump, I've been arguing for years that I think we'd be better off if we had more of a transactional relationship with a Republican president, right? We say, well, these five things are non-negotiable. You can't betray us on court appointments, on this, that, you can name, come up with a list. And then everything else, you can go and you can talk to Democrats or you can talk to Republicans and we can have an argument. You don't have to be a movement guy. We don't have, because there was a part of the problem with Bush. There's a certain populist element to Bush where because of the born-again Christian stuff, because of the being a sort of a Texan populist figure who speaks American and all that, he got away with a lot of things that as a conservative I didn't like. And the compassionate conservatism thing I never liked. I wrote about it a lot. I got a lot of grief at it for it at the time. And it may have been politically necessary, but as a conservative, I didn't feel like I had to agree with it just because it was tactically or strategically something that he needed to do to get elected. And if he wanted to use people like me, not that I matter that much, but you know, my view is, you know, Bill Buckley understood this, that sometimes criticizing Republicans from the right helps Republicans. You know, that we can be, they can try, you know, that's what Bill Clinton understood implicitly, is that being attacked from the left helped him win over people in the middle.
Right.
And if Trump were more politically sophisticated, he would understand this and actually have something of a Faustian bargain with places like the Weekly Standard and National Review and say, hey, look, I'm not that right wing. Those guys are attacking me.
Right.
And so I never thought I was betraying the Republican Party by criticizing the Republican Party. In some ways, I thought it was kind of helping. But at the end of the day, it doesn't matter whether I'm helping or hurting the Republican Party. My job is not to do that.
Right. No, and look, we criticized Harriet Meyer's nomination by George Bush, and I remember, God, the White House was furious.
Yeah.
And we ended up with Justice Alito, so I always cite that as an example. Oh, you shouldn't, you know, go against, you're on the team, you got to be on the team. Ridiculous. We're much better, country's much better off to have Sam Alito as the
justice.
If only
we had done that with Souter.
Yeah, you know? Absolutely. I mean, right, that's a good point, actually. You said earlier you thought you'd gotten some things wrong in liberal fascism. It's so rare for an author to ever acknowledge such a thing. So talk a little bit about the book, obviously, but then what have you thought about? Was it a decade ago about that it came out?
It came out in 2008, so 8 years ago.
Yeah.
And coming up on 9. For those who don't know the book or have only heard what the left has said about the book, I'm not saying that all liberals are fascists. I'm not saying they're like Nazis. The phrase liberal fascism actually comes from H.G. Wells, who people forget. Now that people just remember him as a science fiction guy, but he was actually arguably, if not the most important, clearly one of the top five most influential figures on a whole generation of progressive writers, and both in America and in the UK. And he's quoted from the pulpit and sermons by progressive preachers, social gospel preachers all across the country. When he met with FDR, it was treated like a papal visit. Mm-hmm. And in 1932, H.G. Wells was asked by the young liberals, sort of the youth arm of the Liberal Party, whatever it was called, to come and speak and sort of lay out his vision for the future. And he says, you know, I've been struggling to come up with a label for what I believe in all my life, and I think I finally figured it out. It's, you know, we have to be liberal fascists.
This is after Mussolini is in power as a fascist. I mean, so.
And he says, he also said we have to become enlightened Nazis. And I always thought, what would be the reaction to my book if I called it enlightened Nazism, you know?
Is that right?
Yeah.
And that's, I guess that's before the Nazis come to power.
It's on the cusp of power, but it's not the, you know, Kristallnacht and that stuff.
He means National Socialist in the literal sense. I mean, in the early sense.
If you go back and you read H.G. Wells, it is full of guys in black turtlenecks, Superman, Ubermenschen, coming in,
plant experts.
Sort of Morlocks and Eloy. I mean, there's lots of populism, lots of technocracy, lots of sort of progressive experts and technocrats, and that what matters is will and using political force to bring us into the sunny uplands of history. Anyway, it's all that kind of stuff. And but in no way did I think H.G. Wells want to round up Jews or any of that kind of stuff. And frankly, Mussolini didn't want to round up Jews either.
Right.
I mean, the chapter of Italian fascism and what we think of when we think of fascism does not coalesce very well, or comport very well. Mussolini opposed all the Nuremberg laws for a long time, and Jews were overrepresented in the Italian Fascist Party, but that's all digression, which you can happily cut out. Anyway,
but that's why people like Franklin Roosevelt could say that they, or people close to him, I don't know if he ever said it, could say they admired what Mussolini was doing.
Well, they all did. I mean, I mean, even my sainted Winston Churchill called him one of the great lawgivers, you know, and, FDR had said that we were doing a lot of the things they were doing in Germany and in Italy just in a more orderly way, which I always loved the word orderly, right?
Yeah,
it's
right.
Like the main critique of fascism was that they weren't orderly enough.
Yeah.
And Hugh Johnson, who was the head of the War Industries Board under Woodrow Wilson, and part of my argument is that basically FDR is just a continuation, he's a Wilson retread. You know, we tend to think of these things as two different eras, But it was only 12 years separating the Wilson administration and the FDR administration, and the things that happened under Woodrow Wilson should make every American shudder. First propaganda ministry in the modern world. You had goonish thugs who were beating people up in public, working under the color authority of the state. You had massive waves of censorship. We put, I don't think it was 2,000 political prisoners. We put a lot of political prisoners in jail. Had to be released by the Republicans, by the way.
Yeah, right. Isn't Eugene Debs, the socialist leader?
Yeah, Eugene
leader,
Debs, you know, has
to, released by
Harding.
I think.
And you go down the list, right? These terrible fascistic things that if you describe them objectively, you would say, wow, that sounds pretty fascistic. And but Hugh Johnson, who ran the War Industries Board under Wilson, was the head of the NRA under Roosevelt, National Recovery Administration, not the National Rifle Association, he hung a portrait of Benito Mussolini on his office wall. This is the guy who was the man of the year, 1934 in Time. And when he gets to his office, he hangs a picture of Benito Mussolini on his wall. He hands out tracts printed by the fascist regime in Italy to fellow cabinet members. And during the Democratic Convention, he had issued this sort of somewhat jokey memo to all the Democrats saying what we need to do is get FDR in office and then ship Congress and the Supreme Court off to an island for 90 days so we can really get things done, right? And so there's this tendency in liberalism to idealize what William James called the moral equivalent of war, right? And once you start listening for it, it is everywhere in the rhetoric and in the writing of American liberalism going back 100 years. FDR explicitly said that we're going to take the war powers that Wilson used to fight the Great Depression. Woodrow Wilson was supported by the progressives, not so much because of the foreign policy stuff, but because of this moral equivalent of war argument. John Dewey and Jane Addams and all those guys liked the idea that war would cause regimentation. And I think Dewey has this line where he says, war will cause everybody to lay down their personal interest and rally around the state, right? JFK has his New Frontier, which is explicit moral equivalent of war. Jimmy Carter in his fetching sweater in the Oval Office when he's talking about making the energy crisis the moral equivalent of war. Barack Obama with his Sputnik moments and all of this kind of this Cold War nostalgia that we have to rally around. Or what I thought was, and this would be a better topic for you to discuss with Mansfield, one of the most disgusting State of the Union addresses given at least since Wilson, or no, at least since FDR's 1944 address, which was really disgusting too, was Barack Obama's, I think it was 2006 address, where he says, wouldn't it be great, not 2006, I'm sorry,
2010,
where he says, wouldn't it be great if we could all be like SEAL Team 6, where we just put down our partisan interests and our petty disputes and fought together as one people for a cause, right? And he goes on with this extended metaphor about how
this is after Bin Laden. Maybe it's 2012, I guess.
Yeah, I guess it's 2012. Yeah. And it's this extended metaphor about how SEAL Team 6 epitomizes what America should really be like. And it is a complete inversion of the founders' idea of what America should be like. We have a military to protect our liberties at home, not to provide a model for best practices. You know?
Yeah, right.
By definition, militaries sacrifice personal liberty for a specific purpose, and they take orders from the state because they have to. But they do that, in America at least, so that the rest of us don't have to. And anyway, so this theme runs straight through American liberalism.
I think in one of Obama's, I think maybe 2009 or 2010 address, I think Mansfield wrote about this in the Weekly Standard at the time, and others commented on it. He says, let's pass health care reform. I want to be the last president who has to call for passing health care reform.
Right.
So let's end it here.
Yeah.
But when you think about it for a minute, it's a deeply undemocratic and illiberal thing to say. You know, this is the sort of the expertise will be imposed, and that's it. The debate's over. You know?
Well, and this theme runs through American liberalism going way back as well. You had, what was his name? I think Stuart Butler is one of the brain trusters, said that we need to just simply give over to an economic dictatorship where we just took it out of the hands of democracy. JFK at Yale, and again at a commencement address in Yale, and again at a press conference at the White House, talks about how some issues are just too complicated to leave to democracy, right? And you can go down, look at Gruber, Jonathan Gruber, saying, you know, it's okay to basically lie to the American people about all these things because we just got to get it done. Or Nancy Pelosi saying, yeah, what's in it, you know. And you go down the list, and so there's this technocratic authoritarian tendency. They don't like war, but they like everything else about war. And John Dewey and William James were at least open and honest about this. And that is sort of the liberal fascist tendency. There are other things I get into and all that. And the argument that I made, that there are a bunch of different arguments I made that annoyed people, but part of the implicit in this argument is that I've always view fascism and Nazism as not being right wing. If your definition of conservatism is in the Anglo-American tradition, right? In the Anglo-American tradition, there are essentially two pillars of conservatism. There is, we can call it the anti-statist or libertarian tradition, which says limited government, the sovereignty of the individual, free trade, free markets, free minds, all that stuff, right? And there are lots of different labels for it, whether it's Herbert Spencer or Jefferson, you know, that's one strain of it. And then the other strain is the social conservatism. And
Traditionalism,
it doesn't necessarily have to be open faith in God, but it has to be respect for tradition, respect for the transcendent. That was why William F. Buckley always said that Ayn Rand couldn't be a conservative because she had contempt for the transcendent. Right. You know, you'd be a non-believer, but you can't hate the believers. And those are,
but that also limits the state, limits politics.
That's right, and both are checks. And
sort of Hayek and Burke, or whatever you want to say.
Right. But going by that definition, fascists and Nazis were just simply not conservative. Right. And you could make an argument about them being right wing, but even that, I mean, we can go deep in the weeds on this. The whole reason why they originally started called right wing is because, Joseph Stalin in 1932, 28, I can't remember now, issues his social theory of fascism. And as you remember, communists used to issue theories as if they were like fatwas or encyclicals. And he issues this theory of social fascism, which basically said any progressive left-wing movement anywhere in the world that isn't loyal to Moscow is objectively fascist. And so all of a sudden, overnight, Moscow is saying that FDR is a fascist, John Dewey is a fascist, that Italian fascism is obviously fascist. And the reason for it is that there was this deep split among statists around the world between nationalists and internationalists. Trotsky lost that fight, right? But for a while, what the communists said was, you have to be loyal to Moscow if you are going to be a legitimate left-winger. And American useful idiots, Western useful idiots, intellectuals throughout academia bought into this line that basically said, you know, Norman Thomas, according to Moscow, the head of the American Socialist Party, was a fascist. And it had nothing to do with objective criteria of what a fascist believes in. And if you go back and you look at the Nazi Party platform, which calls for all sorts, I mean, to take out the stuff about the Jews, it's all this stuff about, you know, socializing department stores and getting rid of their equivalent of their Wall Street, and all, it's all this populist economic stuff. Same thing with the Mussolini program, although that kept changing. They were statists. And this is something that Albert J. Nock recognized. There was something that Mencken recognized. You know, there were just different kinds of statists. And so I, going by the lodestar of what I consider to be a conservative in the Anglo-American tradition, this belief that our rights come from God, not from government, that we are citizens, not subjects, and all that kind of stuff, these guys just simply aren't conservative. And so the problem was, here's what I got wrong, right, in this context, and I'm sorry for rambling. What I got wrong was I basically exonerated a lot of the right from these sorts of tendencies. The way I always put it, and I exonerated America from these sorts of tendencies, I always said, look, I am not afraid of the sort of Orwellian conception of a fascist dictator ever taking over here. I think the American people were too good, were too dogmatic about our understanding of the state and our liberties. But what I always was worried about was the Brave New World version, the Aldous Huxley version of this, right? Where we, and you do see this around. I still don't. I haven't changed my mind about this. This is a real danger.
The nanny state, the Tocqueville kind of
that's right.
soft despotism.
The soft despotism, the delivering of prepackaged joy to people, where you don't have to work for it. We try to take the struggle out of life out of it for people. You know, and 10th grade English majors have been vexed by the question, what is wrong with the Brave New World if everyone's happy, right? Take your Soma and you're all happy, right? And you can see with virtual reality and all the things that are coming down the pike how this is a real threat. And so the only way I ever thought that you would ever get a man on a white horse kind of fascist dictator in this country is that first you had to breed a whole generation of what C.S. Lewis called men without chests. And then they will look for a man of vigor and become a cult person. But that's a long way off, right? And I always thought this country could break the back of a dictator. And I always thought, at least when I was writing the book, that conservatives in particular are simply too beholden to our ideology to ever countenance somebody who would essentially promise to be an authoritarian who didn't care about our principles and all that. And I want to be very clear. I don't think Donald Trump is a Hitler. I think if Donald Trump turned into a Hitler, this country would chew him up and spit him out in about 5 minutes. I don't think he's an anti-Semite. I think the problem is he thinks a lot of his followers are anti-Semites, and he doesn't want to offend them, which is not as disgusting as being an anti-Semite, but it's only one or two notches down.
Yeah. Right.
And but at the same time, he is playing upon themes and making arguments and bringing out of many of the most loyal conservatives on the right aspirations and desires and emotional tendencies and states of mind that I really thought couldn't be brought out. And as a trial run for a post-Trump figure who, I've imagined if some serious general, a Douglas MacArthur guy with somewhat less patriotic inclinations, came in, you could see, going by the ardor for Trump, I could see people falling for that. And I just did not feel like that was in us. And I was wrong about that. And it's dismaying. And that's one of the things, and I should be very clear about one thing. I see no meaningful distinction between socialism and nationalism. If you read any speech by Hugo Chavez or Fidel Castro, and you replace the word nationalist with socialist and socialist with nationalist, the meaning changes not a whit. When you nationalize an industry, you're socializing an industry. We have at this moment, Hillary Clinton fended off Bernie Sanders, but he clearly captured the hearts and minds of that party, and she had to move to where he is. We're living in a moment where one party is being taken over by nationalism and another party is being taken over by socialism, and maybe it's because my last name is Goldberg, I tend not to like it when our politics give over to national socialism. And it's not the national socialism of the Nazis, but as a small government, sort of traditional conservative guy, I feel homeless in a way that I never have in my entire life.
Yeah, that's well said. I mean, what do you think about this, the argument? I've sort of been toying with this recently. I mean, conservatism is a funny term to capture what we mostly think. It's sort of an accident of history that the Conservative Party became the bearer of some genuinely traditionalist conservatism, but also a lot of liberalism. I mean, belief in liberal democracy, belief in liberty, what Hayek called the party of liberty, and Hayek wrote that great essay, Why I'm Not a Conservative.
Right.
And sometimes I've toyed with the notion, maybe we need to recover and reappropriate the term liberal, I guess, or maybe it's been so destroyed by America, by liberalism, and progressivism has co-opted liberalism. But now that the liberals want to be progressives, maybe we should, because liberal, I mean, in a way, as an appeal against what you just eloquently discussed, both nationalism and socialism, the liberals, in a way, captures more of what we're...
I think that's exactly right. And this is a huge peeve of mine going way back, because many libertarians will cite the Hayek essay and say, you can't quote Hayek or something like that. And if you actually read the essay, what he's saying, the conservatives he's talking about are people like De Maistre and these continental conservatives.
Yeah, blood and altar.
Blood and soil, right? And he says America is the one place in the world where you can be call yourself a conservative and be a defender of liberty.
Right.
And for young viewers out there who are interested in this stuff, one of the greatest essays ever written on this subject, other than the Hayek one, was Sam Huntington's Conservatism as an Ideology. I think it's 1956 or something like that. And in which he argues that conservatism and radicalism are the only two schools of thought that have no implicit and inherent content. They are entirely contextual. I'm sure you had the same frustrations as, you know, like my dad did and as I did, but I remember my dad just getting so furious the way the New York Times would always call the staunchest Bolsheviks in the Politburo the conservatives,
right?
But there's a certain truth to it. They were conserving their political faith, and in America, we're conserving a liberal revolution.
Right.
And the principles of a liberal revolution, and I think the libertarians might want the word liberal back too. Yeah. We could have a fun argument with them about that. But it is a weird hiccup of history, because in Europe, if you call yourself a liberal, you're one of us,
right?
And for the most part, you know, it depends on the country. But if you call yourself a conservative in Portugal, you're for the monarchy. If you call yourself, you know, and this is one of the reasons why, just to beat a dead horse, why Hitler was not a conservative. Hitler hated Weimar democracy, but he was always dead set against restoring monarchy. You know, he was a radical.
Or the traditionalists, and his deepest, his greatest opponents in some ways. He had some on the left also, to be fair, but some of his greatest opponents, his most courageous opponents, were the conservatives.
Exactly,
sort of old-fashioned, you know, conservatives who did not believe in
Prussians with sunny hats.
National socialism,
Well,
this is where I suppose if Trump loses or wins, the amount of rethinking that could happen, and maybe renaming almost of ideologies and of parties and of movements could be quite interesting, because it could be a quite a big moment, I think, don't you think?
No, I think that's right. And it's, there is a great frustration, right? The whole reason why liberals call themselves progressives now is they claim it's because conservatives ruined the word liberal and said it's something that's not. But that's not the history of it. The history of it is they call themselves progressives. I mean, Joseph McCarthy and Taft called themselves or used the word liberal positively as late as 1954 or something like that. What happened was is that what Woodrow Wilson did in this country during World War I was so horrible and so discredited that the progressives realized they had to start giving up on the term. And they went casting about for a new term, and it was FDR, it was a big part of the movement to call themselves liberals. But the irony is, by abandoning the word progressive, then you had Henry Wallace and the crazy communists come in and take progressive. And the only reason why liberals gave up the word liberal is that once again they had so discredited a term that they had to come up with something new, and everyone forgot we're progressive men.
Right.
And what drives me crazy about this is,
where do you think in the modern last, where did, have you looked into this, where the progressive, the decision on the left to become progressives again, where does that really come from?
I did look at this a while back, but I can't remember.
It's sort of revealing though, isn't it?
I think it came from, and I could, I'm open to correction on this, but it came from the sort of Green Party series left. Ralph Nader used it a lot. One of the things that a lot of, there was this boomlet, and it was on the right too, in the early 1990s. I remember Newt Gingrich and a lot of these guys, they started looking back at the progressives very fondly, and the left did it too, even more aggressively. And what they liked, first of all, the word progressive is just a good brand, right?
But progress is a good brand, yeah.
And they started using it as a way to sort of triangulate against the sort of liberals in power and distinguish themselves from Clinton and all that.
Yeah.
But I don't know the exact
And I suppose, I mean, one reason I like the term liberal is the other connotations of it are positive. I mean, we're for liberal education, we're for, I think, a liberal society, we're for liberality as a general virtue of people.
The liberal arts, properly
liberal
understood.
Arts. Which does actually get to, I think, the one thing Trump hit on that was so helpful to him, and that's been underestimated. People know immigration helped him and trade maybe, but political correctness, I think that was a kind of genius of his. Not that he'd ever spent any time, if I could say, helping all the groups that you and I have been associated with and the magazines and the people on campus fighting political correctness for 10 to 15 years. He wasn't exactly a big donor, to my knowledge, to the, you know, legal groups that were trying to help students stand up against it, or the, you know, the journals and think tanks that were providing alternatives to it. But nonetheless, he somehow saw that that was something that really annoyed tens of millions of Americans. So, and you've written a lot about political correctness. In a way, your book, The Tyranny of Clichés, is about?
To a certain extent, yeah. I gotta say, I'll offer a slightly different take on this. I think this is another example of how of the sort of Ferris Buellerism, right, where he just stumbled into this thing, because I think it was in our one of our first Twitter fights between me and Donald Trump.
Not between me and you, I swear.
Yes, yes. We don't Twitter fight.
No, exactly.
We use MySpace for that.
Yeah, exactly,
but
right.
One of our first Twitter spats with him, he was just going nuts about how I had to be fired, and it's outrageous, and I'm an idiot, and I'm a fool, and no one watches me, and no one reads my stupid magazine, and all this kind of stuff. You know, whatever. But at one point, I made fun of him, and I said, you know, don't you have something along the lines of, don't you have better things to do than stay up all night tweeting like a 14-year-old girl? And Trump goes ballistic about how sexist I am.
Yeah,
and how I'm making fun, you know, National Review has to fire me because this is just such a violation. And once you look for it, you realize, remember when Jeb Bush in the primaries just had a typical stupid, you know, gaffe where he said something about how he's not going to fund women's health or he doesn't care about women's health. He was clearly talking about abortion and Planned Parenthood and all the politics. And Trump, for a week, kept talking about this guy doesn't believe in women's health and blah, blah, blah. And so Trump is a nearest weapon to hand guy. There is no actual principle governing him. The problem is, what appeals him is that he's so politically incorrect. He's for political incorrectness for me, but not for thee.
Right.
And since he's got such a huge megaphone, when he says outrageous and disgusting things, and he says, you guys are way too politically correct, his fans love it. And when he uses political correctness against his enemies, his fans are either oblivious to it, or they're just so happy to, because they love that he fights, right? I mean, that's his big thing. And so it worked out really well for him. He completely stumbled into it. The idea that he had this really well drawn out theory about political correctness and all that, I don't think is true. I think he is much more of a steroidal Chauncey Gardner character who just has a natural gift from coming out of sort of the fighting pits of reality TV and New York media, and it suited him. And, you know, there's a study out of Harvard which confirms what we've been saying all along, that the mainstream media gave him incredibly favorable coverage up until the moment he became the presumptive nominee,
right.
And now they're turning on him, which we all could have seen, we all saw and predicted and joked about, and so there was a real breakdown in the system where, you know, the New York Times and the Washington Post didn't care about what a terrible person he is or the terrible things he's done until he became the Republican nominee. And now all of these things that everyone, like Joe Scarborough, were all saying, oh, this is working for him. He's got this incredible sort of Svengali sense of where the culture is and where the zeitgeist is. No, it turns out that everyone was giving him special treatment. And now that the special treatment period is over, it's turning out that his supposed brilliance is really kind of an albatross.
Yeah. But still, I don't you think no Obama, no Trump? I mean, the
degree
to which
yes,
conservatives
yes.
watched Obama as a kind of, and policies that were governed by a certain kind of, maybe political correctness isn't the right term, but, you know, we can't call say it's radical Islam, and we have
yes.
to be, you know, very, you know, very
that part, absolutely.
Touchy about everything.
I agree with that entirely, and I think that's one of the classic hallmarks of a populist who doesn't care what the establishment thinks, and I'm going to tell the truth, and I'm going to poke fingers and eyes and all that kind of stuff. And that was certainly a huge part of, we don't need to get back to fascism, but a lot of fascist appeal, that they were just going to overthrow the aristocracy and all the rest. And I think that's a big part of it. And I also think that, you know, we began this conversation talking about how everybody overpromised and underdelivered, and that starts in a lot of ways with Obama, who just wildly, you know, overpromised or allowed other. Whenever you say that Obama overpromised and he promised to end racial discord and all that, people say, "Where did he say that? Where did he say that?" And Obama was, and that's a fair response, but I think it's equally fair to say that he knew exactly what people were projecting upon him, and he took advantage of it. He was a classic charismatic leader in the sense that a diverse group of people could all project upon him their own expectations. And I think that is also true of Trump.
But I've been struck by in that respect, they're so different in many ways, but
yeah.
the comedy. What was the Obama phrase in 2008? He is the, we are the one we have been waiting for.
We are the ones we've been waiting for, which
is a weirdly fascistic,
it is.
I would say, sentiment. And then Trump now is, I love the people. The people love me. I love the people.
Right.
I saw he said that recently, which is also a very weird, inappropriate in a liberal democracy. You're not supposed to love the people. The people aren't supposed to love you.
Right.
You're supposed to be a representative
right.
of the people who, acts according to his own judgment and so forth. Both Obama and Trump have obliterated or at least minimized the healthy kind of distance, you might say.
That's right. That's right. And they're both manifestations of what I've been calling for years the cult of unity, right? And there is a place for unity, but it's one of these things that is taught on college campuses. The single most fascistic thing that is said on a college campus every single day is, if you're not part of the solution, you're part of the problem.
Yeah, that's good.
This idea that there is no safe harbor from politics, all oars must pull in the same direction, is so profoundly anti and un-American in the strictest sense. The symbol of fascism is a bundle of sticks around an axe, right? That's what a fasces is. It goes back to ancient Rome and the Etruscans, and it simply means strength in numbers. When you hear Barack Obama say, government is just another word for those things that we do together, right? Or the opening words of the Democratic Convention in 2012 were, government is the one thing we all belong to. Which I always joke, as a Tea Party guy, that makes me want to flip the safety on my rifle. We don't belong to the government belongs to us. And it gets to the fundamental problem with the cult of unity, which we're now seeing manifest itself on the conservative side, but has been essential to progressivism and liberalism for 100 years, if not more, is that it is fundamentally not an American value. The reason why we have a Bill of Rights is that some things need to be, the majorities need to be prevented from being able to decide certain things. You read the Federalist Papers, and Federalist 10, Federalist 51, the reason why we have divided government and faction against faction and checks and balances and the executive competes with the legislative is precisely because unity is not the highest value. The highest value in the American political tradition is the individual who stands up to the mob, not the mob. And you can go back to Julian Benda. There's this thing that has been in mass politics since the rise of mass man. This comes up time and time again. It's what populism is all about, where politics from time to time becomes what Julian Benda called the organization of political hatreds. And where all of a sudden that's what Julian Benda, for those who don't know, was the author of The Treason of the Clerks, or The Treason of the Intellectuals. And he was talking
in between the wars and France.
Yeah, he sort of predicted everything, right?
Yeah, yeah.
In general terms. And he was looking at the populism that was taking over throughout Europe. And he says, for the first, the treason that he was talking about was that all the intellectuals had given up believing in universal principles and instead were buying into particularist principles. The socialists now said that Jesus was a socialist, and then the Germans said Jesus was a nationalist. And everyone was sort of taking to their corners and arguing against the notion that there were universal human rights or universal human principles, that there were natural rights that applied to all, and instead it was my masses versus your masses. And he has this great line where he says, for the first time in 2,000 years, the intellectuals are siding with the people who gave the hemlock to Socrates. And when you look for it, this is what comes up, and I think we're gonna get more and more of it when you get a flattening of hierarchy, when you get radically disruptive technologies, when you get new industries that come in and come out. There's a reason why fascism comes in Italy, Germany, and the liberal fascist version in the United States when it does. These are the three last big powers to industrialize and to urbanize. And you had millions of people moving off of farms and out of settled traditional communities, and they were thrown into the switches of industrial capitalism and urban America, often separated from their families, separated from their traditions, and they felt alienated and deracinated, and they looked about for a new sense of meaning and belonging. And FDR, certainly morally way better than the other guys did, nonetheless caught on to this, and he started talking about how he appealed to the forgotten man. And I'm glad he did, because he headed off worst populists, Father Coughlin and Huey Long and all those guys. But I think we live in a moment with the changes in technology, the changes in the way, and with family breakdown, where there are not the institutions that traditionally give us a sense of meaning, and that is the feedstock for populism. And the way I always put it in speeches is, you know, the Democrats have a much better story to tell about how the government can love you, right? That the government you belong to the government. Robert Nisbet, who you probably knew.
Yeah, I've very read close it, to my parents.
I loved Robert Nisbet. Wrote a wonderful book.
Late sociologist. Died about 15 years ago, 20 years ago.
Yeah, one of the great sociologists of the 20th century. Wrote a book called The Quest for Community. And he argued that every totalitarian movement in the 20th century was fundamentally an attempt to, in a modern age, deliver a sense of community that people felt they had lost. And when Barack Obama goes around saying government is the one thing you can belong to, he's not talking about you being a serf. He's talking about you feeling like you belong to something. My problem is that siren song. The federal government can't love you, right? And you can only be loved by family and local institutions and places where you physically live. You can't be loved as an abstraction. And I think that Donald Trump has figured out in his thumbless grasp of politics a right-wing version of this, or a conservative version of it, and say, I'm going to take care of you. You can belong. Your passion is my will and all that. Yeah. And it clicks with people. And as someone like you who just feels, who's not ensorcelled by it, right? I look at the same guy. I don't get it. Do you see in this guy? We're just on the sidelines for a while.
Yeah, well, we try to oppose it, and people might come to their senses, and certainly.
Sure.
But let me then close with this question. So young people, especially, I think, let's say you're not thrilled with this campaign. If it ends up being Clinton and Trump, and there's no good third party, and Trump is the nominee, and you want to not focus entirely on this dispiriting prospect for your own country's future. So let's say you've mentioned very interestingly several books and authors, but if I were a young person, I might take the fall and say, you know what, I think I'll try to read one good book every week or two,
yeah,
in addition to, and instead of focusing obsessively on the electoral college map and between Clinton and Trump. So what, I mean, you mentioned some authors, but I'm just curious, what would you suggest as kind of, you've read widely and obviously been influenced by a lot of authors, are the people who influence you the most, people you recommend the most to young people or not young people?
Sure.
People who are obscure, who are ignored, any of those categories.
Sure. I mean, I'll sort of free associate for a second. And for those who don't know, in my post-college life, probably one of the biggest influences on me was actually your dad, which we've talked about before. I remember coming to AEI as a Xeroxing policy gnome and just sort of being blown away listening to your dad talk. And I ended up going back and reading a lot of his stuff. And so, Reflections of Neoconservative. It's not really about neoconservatism. There's one chapter, that sort of like, but some of the essays in there, particularly The American Revolution as a Successful Revolution, was really eye-opening to me and very useful. Beyond that, if you're actually interested in the popular...
Of course people should read National Review and the Weekly Standard.
Stipulate that.
And read the books and other articles by people who write for those magazines.
And
that's
a good
way to start.
One should read or at least buy any book I've written. And but
very cheap if you want the used copies.
That's right. if you're actually interested in the populism stuff, I'll do a little bit on liberal writers just to show that I'm an ecumenical mind. Alan Brinkley's Voices of Protest, which is basically on Huey Long and Father Coughlin and that genre. It's a fantastic, readable, very scholarly, sound book. A good reader could read it very quickly. Another history of liberalism that I really loved, which no one remembers anymore, is, I can't remember his first name, Goldman's Rendezvous with Destiny.
Yeah, Eric, I think.
Eric Goldman, yeah. It was a Columbia University professor. I really loved that book. Beyond that, I am a major Hayek nerd. I can't say that I've read every page of law, legislation, and all the constitutional liberty and all that stuff. But a great introduction to Hayek is the Fatal Conceit. It was his last book. There's some controversy about how much of it he completely wrote, but it doesn't matter. It's a great book. I think that It's a little heavier going, but Conflict of Visions by Tom Soles, very useful for college kids to read.
I agree that book is sort of weird, and I came to it late. I mean, yeah. I already studied all kinds of stuff, but it's extremely clear somehow. It's very I've run into more people than I would have expected who really were influenced by that book, including I was teaching something in Israel, you know, three months ago, and someone who was a young kind of liberal in the old-fashioned sense, sort of libertarian, conservative type, trying to advance that in Israel, not a country that has, unfortunately, as much of that tradition as it should have. And he said, the book that's simple, I asked him, what, did you read Hayek? Did you read Phil Buckley? Did you read, you know, other, I think Milton Friedman? No, it was Tom Sowell. What's it called? The Conflict of Visions.
Conflict of Visions. Yeah. And I think it's one of those things that once you get the idea he's talking about, the rest is just examples of what he means by it, but it's a very useful way of thinking about the sort of psychological differences between left and right, or conservatives and liberals.
What influence, I mean, growing up, is there one or two books in college or late high school or early,
you know,
post-college that had the most influence on you? I mean, because your parents were intellectuals of a way.
My dad was definitely an intellectual. Yeah. My dad was a shot, and one of the reasons why I loved Irving so much, it was like listening to my father reason through an argument absent my father's shyness about public speaking. I grew up, you know, my family, we subscribed to, because it was part of my dad's job, he ran newspaper syndicates, and before that was a newspaper editor. And so we had, I don't know, 10 newspapers and 35 magazines in the house. Yeah. And my dad's idea of vacation was going from one side of the couch to the other side of the couch to read a different book or a different magazine. And a big part of my intellectual education came from the fact that my dad's favorite hobby, really, other than the reading part, was going on long walks with his kids and explaining why the New York Times was wrong and why Stalin was a bad man and all this kind of stuff. And so I kind of fought becoming a conservative. I didn't plan on, not a professional conservative or a journalist. I wanted to write comic books and science fiction growing up. And
is that right?
Yeah. I kind of fell over backwards into a lot of
things. Who were your favorite science fiction writers?
I loved Frank Herbert.
That's not something I was ever into.
I mean, it's what, you know, the old joke of the golden age of science fiction is 16, you know?
Yeah, right. Whoever was big then.
Yeah, or whatever you read when you were 16 your mind is open to that stuff. And so for what Game of Thrones is for a lot of teenagers today, Frank Herbert's Dune and all that kind of stuff was very big for me. I actually think at least the first installment of the trilogy got really silly the series got really silly after a while, but the first installment of that actually has some wonderful treatments of politics that,
is that right?
Were really kind of interesting.
Do you agree that a lot of science fiction, it does seem to be libertarian in its impulse? Am I wrong about that? It's sort of dystopian about planning and about, you know, this sort of excessively progressive view of the future, it seems to me. I mean, much of it, but Heinlein and Philip K. Dick and all these sort of well-known writers.
Oh, it's funny you say, you know, it's funny you say that, because I think it comes and goes. Certainly, if you look at, like, Edward Bellamy, who wasn't really a science fiction writer, but he had this futuristic vision and backwards, right? And it was the greatest image, Edward Bellamy, no one has heard of now, but was a big writer, wrote a huge bestseller called Looking Backwards, and was set 100 years from 1890, whatever,
yeah,
right?
1900, yeah.
And the greatest image in it is how we have finally overthrown the stupidity of liberal democratic capitalism and solitary individualism, and the symbol of this is how we've all gotten rid of individual umbrellas, and instead, a canopy's come out and cover everybody
right?
again.
He was H.G. Wells again, right?
Then there's H.G. Wells, who is thoroughgoingly fascist.
Yeah, I guess I'm thinking of people in the 50s and 60s. It seems
right.
Like post-World War II, post-Nazi, post-Stalin.
And I think
kind
that's
of
the
a
point.
Reaction.
And there's a pendulum to it. And I'm not a huge student of the politics of science fiction.
Anyway, I'm just curious.
But I think, but the funny thing is, because I'm working on this other book, which I hope I'll come back on to talk about, someday, if I actually finish it.
Yeah, don't put pressure on yourself here.
must get it done. But one of the things I love, what I think is fundamentally conservative about science fiction in the small c sort of most philosophical sense, is one of my favorite definitions of conservatism that I think I first heard from Glenn Lowry, is this idea that human nature has no history, right? That, as your dad always loved to quote Ayn Rand, he always used to say, Every generation, Western civilization is invaded by barbarians. We call them children, right? And so you get modern democratic man if you raise children to become modern democratic man. If you don't and you leave them to their own devices, they become Lord of the Flies. And one of the things I love about science fiction, even though I haven't read much of it in 20 years, I have to say, is that while technology and landscapes and environments, these things all change, the one constant is human nature. And that's what makes it accessible. And that's what's so fundamentally conservative about it, is that I think at least these days, it's very bad science fiction to have characters that don't seem like human beings. And to write about how politics or technology is going to make us all better and make us perfect. First of all, it's really boring science fiction. And second of all, it violates this notion that human nature actually has no history, and that the eternal questions, the things that philosophers and writers have been dealing with for thousands of years, these eternal truths, they endure. And that comes through in science fiction, and I don't think people take it. That's one of the reasons why politics and science fiction can be so interesting, because all the technology is different, and they've got these spaceships, and they've got these bombs, and they've got all these things. And yet the same issues about mobilizing coalitions and dealing with intrigue, those are endemic to human nature, and they come up in any climate or environment that you put them in.
That's well said. So any other books? I took us off on a slight digression.
Yeah, I apologize. You can cut all that.
I know so little about it. No, it's interesting, actually. Essayists who affected you, I don't know, you know.
So I grew up reading a lot of, a lot of commentary, a lot of New Republic. I didn't read that much National Review.
Is that right? That's ironic.
I really didn't. I went back and sort of...
The National Review had a big effect on me. I'm older, and there, Buckley, just the intransigence of National Review was bracing.
Yeah.
I always think Buckley does not get enough credit, and Bill Rusher and the early people at National Review, it wasn't really where my parents were, and there's a certain tendency after the rise of neoconservatism to say, well, that kind of early conservatism was a little simple-minded and too sort of anti-American in certain aspects, and anti-New Deal, and there were some truth to some of those criticisms. It was kind of a complicated thing.
We can get into a debate about it.
But I thought they never got enough credit for just being willing to, as Buckley said, stand athwart history.
Yelling stop.
That was a very, as a young person for me, that was a very important just notion that you could do that.
Yeah.
That was a very smart, well-educated guy and his cohort who were very smart, well-educated.
Right.
If you read the early National Review, were willing to just say to all the progressive conventional wisdom, no.
Right.
No.
Right.
That was, I think, a very great contribution they made, you know.
No, I agree with that entirely. And
they were wrong on a whole bunch of issues, civil rights, they got some things, the philosophic basis for what they were saying was a little murky at times.
No, I agree with that too.
But it was very important, I think.
Yeah. Witness, I think, is an important thing for people.
Yeah, that is an amazing book, I think.
And I gotta say, the audience here will appreciate it probably more than the average, even literate audience. But I gotta say, George Nash's conservative intellectual movement since 1945 is still sort of, it's one story about conservatism, and there are other stories that kind of get left out, but it is really brilliantly done. If you want to understand where the sort of the deep roots of the icebergs that we see today, how far they go back, and when Wilmore Kendall and going from being a populist to a Straussian and all these things, partly it's my history. It's my origins as a comic book guy, but there's a certain kind of comic book guy who's just obsessed with the origin stories.
Right.
And when I sort of fell over backwards in 91, 92 into starting to become a real conservative and being interested in this stuff, I was always interested in philosophy, but I didn't see it as a conservative versus liberal thing. I did huge deep dives on all of this stuff, and I actually, the first book I tried to write was a really stupid book. And I mean that in the most technical sense. It was, I got a contract in like 96 to write the 100 most influential conservatives of all time. And there was a big series in the 1990s, the 100 most important Jews, the 100 most important blacks, whatever. And I was going to do the 100 most important conservatives. And the idiotic conceit of it was that it had to be a ranking. So you had to do Aristotle first or whatever it was, right? And we can have that argument. But they also wanted 50% of it to be contemporary conservatives. So I had to, they wanted me to basically say, Irving Kristol is the 17th most important conservative of all time. And then, of course, there's Pliny the Elder, who's the 18th. And it was totally arbitrary nonsense. But what it helped me really do is, because I overdid it, and I thought if I just read enough books and I read enough stuff, I'll know this. And I'd already been at AEI for a few years as a research assistant, sort of obsessed with unraveling all of these knots that I encountered, and I hung out with all these young Straussian kids and all that. And I got to say, the Nash book is just a great book for that. There's also a wonderful short book called The Conservative Tradition in America by two guys we know whose name escapes me. It's almost 20 years old, but it's a very useful book.
Well, that's good. That's good. The lesson I take from your intro, I hadn't known about the book you didn't write, but the lesson I take from that is that one should read a lot, and one probably shouldn't write the first book that one thinks one should write, right?
No, that's probably right. And I remember when I was working on it, I said to my dad,
you shouldn't publish the first book one.
Yes, I couldn't finish it, because I was a television producer at the time and I couldn't do everything. And I remember talking to my dad, and I said, "Dad, I'm just too busy. I can't get this done. I got to read all these things, and it's such a weird book." And my dad said, "You know, Alexander Solzhenitsyn wrote his book on a roll of toilet paper in prison. Yeah. I'm sure you're having an easier time of it."
He wasn't a big buck up the kid with a lot of warm, he was a little more of a tough love guy there.
He was tough, but I shot back at him. I said, look, Dad, Solzhenitsyn had nothing else to do.
Solzhenitsyn's worth reading.
Solzhenitsyn's absolutely worth reading.
That Harvard speech, the commencement speech of 1978 is bracing even today.
I was always more of a magazine guy, and so I or essay guy.
Yeah, well,
so it's sort of like your dad. That's one of the reasons I love your dad's stuff. Yeah. Especially for college kids, since that's, I guess, part of the emphasis here. Robert Goldwyn's Why Blacks, Women, and Jews Aren't Mentioned in the Constitution. It's an incredibly useful thing for college kids who are being told that leaving out black women and Jews is a sign of the inherent evilness of the Constitution.
And that was a collection of essays?
It was just one essay, but it was also the title of a collection of essays.
Okay, yeah.
But it was the chief essay in it. Yeah. It's a great essay. It really helps you sort of understand things like the three-fifths clause and all that kind of stuff. So.
That's a good, slightly bizarre, but good note to end on. And I very much admired Robert Goldwyn, who edited actually a whole bunch of essays that people should go back and look at.
Yep.
He had an annual conference. He was at AEI.
Sure.
And many people, Walter Burns, my father, Martin Diamond, would come to these conferences and give papers. And I think they were collected often in volumes, annual, biannual, whatever.
Yeah.
But if one goes back and looks, you can find an awful lot of good material in those different volumes.
Absolutely.
A lot of good stuff written. One has to, but one can't read everything when one learns that.
No, and one can't come close.
And can't rank the 100 top conservatives of all time.
I have many rough drafts of lists.
You should publish that sometime. Once you finish your next book.
Yeah.
You tell us at least the title of the next book, and then we'll.
A working title of it, and it's very much a working title, is The Tribe of Liberty.
Oh.
And we'll leave it there. So.
Okay, well, we look forward to having you back on Conversations to discuss it.
I would love to do that.
Jonah Goldberg, thanks very much
for
joining me today. Thank you for joining me on Conversations.